Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Virtual Training, the art of conducting powerful virtual training that engages learners and makes knowledge stick, by Jeb Blount. Narrated by Jeb Blount and Jamie Renell.
Forward. I'm the first to admit that I thought that in-person training was the only real way to teach people. I never imagined that I'd be delivering hundreds of hours of virtual training to audiences around the world from my virtual training studio on my farm in New Jersey. But as Jeb will share with you, our organization was forced to pivot fast in the spring of 2020 as the global pandemic raced around the globe. Our survival rested on my training team quickly embracing and mastering virtual training delivery. It was not easy. Some of our trainers were in a momentary state of denial, but Jeb challenged us to adopt a new set of beliefs and think differently about virtual training. He pushed us out of our comfort zones. He demanded that we elevate our craft and deliver a legendary virtual learning experience. My training team implemented and executed the exact techniques and tactics laid out in this book, and the results have been nothing short of remarkable. Mastering virtual instructor-led training has allowed us to scale faster, deliver more training, and make a massive and lasting impact on our clients' learners and their organizations. More importantly, these techniques have made our master trainers better than they ever were before. We now seamlessly blend classroom-based training, virtual instructor-led training, and self-paced e-learning in ways we never thought possible, to deliver a far higher ROI for our stakeholders. An important and undeniable truth is that the organizations that continually train and develop their people build an unassailable competitive edge. These organizations are more agile, attract and retain top talent, and win. Within these learning organizations, learning and development professionals are under constant pressure to source, develop, and deliver impactful training that is relevant, engaging, and sticks over the long haul. But you already know this, which is why you are reading this book. It's likely that you pick this book up because you are seeking answers to the same pressing questions being asked by the leaders of forward-thinking organizations. How can we leverage virtual training to deliver more training at a lower cost while making an even bigger impact? How do we leverage virtual training to accelerate, elevate, and advance learning initiatives? How do we evolve as a learning and development organization and stay ahead of the curve? How do we make virtual training more engaging and impactful? How do I teach my trainers, or myself, to be comfortable delivering a high-quality experience in the virtual classroom? In virtual training, Jeb Blount, who is one of the most celebrated trainers of our generation, answers these questions and delivers a blueprint for leveraging virtual instructor-led training to accelerate the velocity of learning initiatives and make training stick. He gives you step-by-step instruction for leveraging technology, building virtual training sets, designing, and delivering engaging, high-quality virtual training that learners and their leaders will embrace. You will learn the keys to future-proofing both yourself and your organization. Most importantly, you will learn how to elevate your craft and deliver a legendary virtual learning experience. I can tell you from firsthand experience that when you adopt and implement the techniques laid out in this book, you will begin making a far bigger impact than you ever thought possible, now and in the future. This book matters because now, more than ever, we must think differently about the value of virtual instructor-led training and where it fits into broader learning initiatives. Virtual Training is a rare transformational book that will reshape the way you and your organization view and deliver virtual instructor-led training forever. Keith Lubner, Executive Vice President and Head of Training and Consulting, Sales Gravy.
Special note: free virtual training resources. Virtual training covers the fundamentals, which will likely remain constant, but it's impossible to include everything you need. the tools, technology, and trends in virtual training are constantly changing. So I created a place to keep you updated on the techniques that will give you an edge as you grow your virtual training skills. The companion website to this book will keep you up to date and give you a place to dig into the details about our favorite tools, the ones that we use at Sales Gravy, and recommended apps and other tips. As a special bonus, to thank you for purchasing this book, you get free access to these resources. You can visit the companion website using this special exclusive code, which will give you free access. Go to the following website and follow the instructions. The website address is salesgravy.com/VT. That's salesgravy.com/VT. The access code, all caps, is VTB2021X. That's all caps, VTB2021X. Part 1. The Virtual Training Tsunami. The only way you survive is you continuously transform into something else. Jeannie Rometty, Executive Chairman of IBM. Chapter 1. Just like that, everything changed. An instant wave of panic came over me as I came face to face with the gravity of the situation. The COVID-19 pandemic had made its way around the world. 2 days earlier, I delivered a keynote to 6,000 people. I didn't know it then, but it would be the last time I'd walk onto a physical stage or into a physical classroom for almost a year. Before COVID, my training and consulting company, Sales Gravy, had been on a hyper-growth trajectory. Our master trainers were on the ground delivering training on every continent except Antarctica. The year before, I'd spent 311 nights in hotel rooms, clocking over 200,000 air miles as I crisscrossed the globe delivering keynotes, workshops, and trainings to a who's who of the most prestigious organizations in the world. With the economy on fire and our company growing at an ever-increasing pace, my trainers and I were road warriors. Our training calendar was packed, and my sales team was inundated with calls and emails from even more companies that wanted to hire us. And I was getting regular inquiries from venture capital and private equity firms that wanted to discuss potential investments. It felt like we were unstoppable. And then, just like that, everything changed. A global pandemic, travel bans, social distancing, working from home, panic. In a heartbeat, we were grounded. And we were not alone. Educators, instructors, and trainers were all confronting a harsh reality. Classrooms were empty, and livelihoods were on the line. It was chaos, and we were in an all-hands-on-deck battle to save our company. I remember sitting down with my company CFO to figure out how long we could keep paying our trainers if we lost all our training contracts. My number one focus was saving the business while retaining the talented people on our team that we'd worked so hard to attract and develop. Meanwhile, customers were ringing our phones off the hook. Most of our scheduled trainings in physical classrooms were being indefinitely postponed. And our account executives were working to calm our panicked clients long enough to move those deliveries to the virtual classroom. As entire companies shifted from working together in office buildings to working from home, the organizations we served were frantically seeking alternatives to classroom learning. And in the midst of this initial shockwave, large companies were laying off members of their learning and development teams. Out-of-work corporate trainers were contacting us in droves. They were looking for advice, a shoulder to cry on, and mostly jobs. The entire education, training, learning, and development industry was being forced to instantly pivot from classroom-based training to virtual training, and most trainers and organizations were woefully unprepared. History is full of transformational points in which smart, innovative people were pressed to invent technology that could help them meet the moment. But at least for those of us in the training world, the powerful, high-quality technology was right in front of us. All we needed to do was catch up. The remote learning tidal wave. In those early months, virtual training felt entirely new. Legions of trainers, disoriented and unsettled, approached virtual training as if they were stumbling into an alien world on some distant planet. Remote learning, instruction, and training, though, is not new. Correspondence courses had been advertised in newspapers since the early 1700s, when the United States was still a colony. The earliest on record was for a course in shorthand that was placed in the Boston Gazette in 1728. It took until the 1920s for colleges to start broadcasting courses over the radio, and by the 1950s, some universities offered courses over broadcast television. Thanks to teleconferencing, in 1976, Coastline Community College in California became the first fully virtual institution. Then, the internet arrived and brought remote learning into a new era. As corporate learning, development, and enablement started investing in new technologies, online courses became mainstream. I took my very first virtual instructor-led course in the late 1990s. It leveraged an online content portal and weekly conference calls with the instructor. That course was audio only. But by the early 21st century, video conferencing technology had become ubiquitous, and virtual instruction and e-learning technology exploded. Massive investment in online learning by corporate and governmental organizations accelerated innovation even more. Over the past 20 years, there's been a 900% market growth rate for online learning. But there was a problem. Most of the investment was focused on self-directed, asynchronous e-learning. Those types of courses aren't instructor-led, meaning students log on whenever they want, consume pre-assigned content, and do some assignments that may or may not be graded or reviewed by anyone. Students and instructors often don't interact, and there's only a limited student community, if there's any at all. Despite these drawbacks, venture capitalists and investors have poured money into e-learning companies, and some e-learning platforms were snapped up by bigger organizations. LinkedIn, for example, paid $1.5 billion for lynda.com. In the online learning boom of the last two decades, there was a massive focus on asynchronous e-learning, while synchronous virtual instructor-led training, or VILT, was mostly treated as an afterthought. Even with all the investment and attention focused on e-learning, only 10% of synchronous training delivery was virtual. Now, don't get me wrong. Plenty of people and technology entrepreneurs were thinking about it. The problem was that, in learning and development, L&D, virtual training was more likely to be talked about than actually delivered. And it didn't help when the initial excitement about massive open online courses, or MOOCs, fizzled with a 94% abandonment rate. My company was one of the few that had been delivering virtual instructor-led training since 2011. These VILT deliveries almost always supplemented our in-person classroom-based courses and were often simple broadcast-style webinars without substantial interaction. It was exceedingly rare that we'd teach an entire course in a purely virtual environment. The primary reason was demand. Our clients and their learners did not want virtual instruction because they saw no value in virtual training. My trainers didn't enjoy delivering virtual training either. It wasn't fun or fulfilling. The virtual environment didn't offer the same emotional high, that juice you get when you walk into a classroom as an instructor. Virtual training was uncomfortable for them. They believed, as did our clients, that the only viable way to really teach people was face-to-face. We were far more likely to get on an airplane and fly 20 hours to Singapore to deliver a two-day classroom-based course to participants who had also flown in from various places across the globe than to teach those same students virtually. In those pre-COVID days, the virtual instruction we delivered was mostly on-screen PowerPoint slides accompanied with live voiceover. Because of this, we were not particularly proud of our VILTs, so we charge very little for them. And that led us and our customers to view virtual training delivery as a low-value option. So we didn't actively pursue the sale of virtual training deliveries. This was where we found ourselves as we entered the spring of 2020. Asynchronous e-learning was sexy. Synchronous face-to-face training was perceived as the most valuable, and virtual instructor-led training was a low-value afterthought. Then, everything changed. For 300 years, remote learning had been meandering to shore on a slow-building tide. In 2020, it became a tsunami that washed away the foundational belief that in-person training was the only real way to teach people. To remain relevant, trainers had to immediately shift the way we were delivering training and engaging learners. Likewise, learners, leaders, and entire organizations had to rethink their negative perceptions of virtual learning. The global coronavirus pandemic moved synchronous virtual instructor-led training into the spotlight and accelerated its broad adoption. Virtual training finally emerged from the shadows and met its moment. As March rolled into April, my team at SalesGravy was catching up fast, scrambling to hold onto our training contracts, retain our customers, and save our company. The good news is we had two things going for us. First, we had already made significant investments in both technology and developing our competency to deliver high-quality virtual training. And second, our customers, trainers, and learners no longer had a choice. The only way to deliver and attend high-quality interactive synchronous training was in a virtual classroom. Chapter 2. Look, Mom, I built a virtual training studio. In January 2019, I sat down with David Montessori, who leads our creative team, and laid out my plan to build a virtual training studio complex at our corporate headquarters from the ground up. There were two things driving this plan. First, I was worried about the inevitability of a recession hitting within 18 to 24 months and that we needed to be prepared. Second, I was very unhappy with the quality of our virtual training deliveries. In recessions, travel budgets always get slashed, which is generally devastating to private training companies and corporate learning and development departments. However, even in recessions, people need training. In fact, when times are bad, elevating and training talent gives organizations a competitive edge. Back in 2019, my plan had been to prepare to shift to high-quality virtual delivery as a hedge for when the next recession hit. I also thought we could do better, whether or not there was a recession. Personally, I wasn't proud of our virtual training performance and quality. Our virtual training deliveries were often poorly planned and delivered on the fly in airports, hotel rooms, and even cars. David and I devised a plan to build broadcast-quality sound studios specifically for virtual training delivery. When we presented the idea to the rest of the team, though, it didn't go over well. My CFO was not happy about the massive expense involved in building the studio. And the sales and training teams thought we were nuts because, in their minds, no one was going to buy virtual training on a scale that could justify the cost to build the studios. To them, I was just another Don Quixote fighting imaginary giants. But we ignored the skepticism and moved forward with construction, building three full-production virtual training studios. A year later, at the beginning of March 2020, the construction crew was still working on the finishing touches, and much of the equipment we'd ordered wasn't even out of the boxes. Then, the pandemic struck, and we worked around the clock for several weeks to get the studios ready for action. This included teaching our trainers to deliver virtual training in a whole new way. Gone forever were the days of voiceover PowerPoint slides. Our trainers stepped out from behind the slides and in front of the camera, and we became laser-focused on delivering a legendary virtual training experience. Our new studios gave us the ability to recreate the feel of being in the classroom and interacting with the instructor. Our people won't accept it. With the studios up and running, we were able to beg, plead, and convince our customers to give virtual training a chance. We sent them pictures of our sets, did virtual tours of our studios, and put on our tap dancing shoes. Many of our clients pushed back against moving their classes to a virtual classroom. The head of learning and development for a large Fortune 500 client argued emphatically, "Our people won't accept it." Like so many of our customers, he worried that it would be a low-quality disaster. Such was his experience. Finally, though, we convinced him to give it a try. He agreed, but he forced us to conduct a twice-per-week planning meeting over the 3 weeks prior to the training. On that first run, we had people from all over the world in the classroom. Traditionally, these folks would have traveled to the company's headquarters for the training, spending hours on airplanes, days in transit, and thousands of dollars to attend the two-day course that we taught for his company. Following the virtual training experience, we surveyed the participants. They gave the experience a 4.9 on a scale of 5. The in-person classroom experience that we had been delivering for the past 3 years averaged a 4.7 across all the previous participant surveys. This was not what the head of L&D was expecting, because up until that point, his experience with virtual training had been dreadful, and his learners had agreed with that assessment. One participant commented, "I'll admit, I didn't want to attend this training, but I'm glad I did. I never thought a virtual training could hold my attention. The training was outstanding." And most other comments from that session followed the same pattern. Our client was convinced, so much so that he hired us to teach his internal trainers to deliver virtual training like ours. This was our very first virtual learning experience train-the-trainer delivery. Today, his organization is delivering more than half of its courses from a virtual classroom, and the course we teach has remained virtual. But that wasn't a one-off experience. In April of 2020, we were confronted by the CEO of a mid-sized business services company that had scheduled a 3-day in-classroom training with us. He demanded a refund for the course because he didn't want it delivered virtually, which at the time was our only choice. On a call, he hit us with a stream of expletives, among them, "I'm not effing doing that to my people." We finally managed to convince him to give the virtual training a try with a guarantee that if he and his people didn't like it, we would give him a full refund. As he entered the virtual classroom, along with his skeptical learners, I'll never forget the look on his face as he mouthed, "Wow." He did not ask for his money back, and we are still delivering virtual training for his company. Virtual training explosion. A couple of weeks later, we were delivering virtual training to a group of sales professionals in India for one of our most valued clients. Because of our history with this company, it hadn't been too difficult to convince them to shift the scheduled physical deliveries to virtual. Still, there were top executives observing the training because there was so much skepticism, and this was true for almost all of our early VILT deliveries. About 10 minutes into the training, we overheard the senior vice president on an unmuted mic calling the CEO and telling him, "You need to log in now because you've never seen anything like this." Subsequently, the company hired us to deliver virtual trainings to participants in countries all across the globe. We began following the sun from Asia to Europe to North America, teaching people from all around the world from our virtual training studios in Georgia. Suddenly, at least in the eyes of my team, I went from a man tilting at windmills to a genius. My trainers bought in, and my salespeople, for the first time, felt confident selling virtual training. Our clients and their learners loved the experience we were delivering. Once they experienced our methodology, they were willing to pay a premium for high-quality virtual instructor-led training. What we hadn't anticipated, though, was that the savings on travel costs and the flexibility that VILTs afforded would cause them to double, triple, and even quadruple the trainings they were ordering. In the middle of the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression, our business exploded. Chapter 3: The Case for Virtual Training. Before I make the case for virtual training, let's acknowledge that dynamic, in-person, in-classroom training can be a powerful learning experience. This is especially true when it includes collaborative breakout sessions and experiential learning elements delivered by a talented, passionate instructor. For many participants, in-person training provides the very best overall experience on an emotional level. Few rational people would argue otherwise. The problem is that classroom-based instructor-led training is both expensive and inefficient. First, there is the investment in the actual training. This includes the cost to pay the trainer and content licensing when you're using third-party curriculum. But there are also the expenses for travel and meals, lost productivity while participants are out of the field and in the classroom, the training space, whether it is a dedicated area in your building or rented space at a hotel or conference center, the printed materials, including name tags, tent cards, handouts, and workbooks, liability insurance, and there are the indirect environmental costs like energy consumption and carbon emissions. More often than not, the investment in the trainer and licensing, if applicable, is dwarfed by the expenses that aren't directly related to the actual training. We surveyed our clients and found that between 50 and 80% of classroom-based instructor-led training investment is spent on non-training expenses like travel. With so much money wasted on incidental expenses, in-person training programs make it challenging to get a return on the investment. These high costs also mean that learning and development organizations cannot afford to experiment or make mistakes with physical classroom training. This stifles innovation, agility, and speed when organizations need to change. These incidental costs also put severe limits on the amount of ongoing training that can be delivered by an organization. The truth is, there will always be a need for in-person classroom instruction for adults. There are some forms of training, for example, how to repair a diesel engine or perform a medical procedure, that require a hands-on learning experience. Yet even this type of training may be blended and enhanced with e-learning, virtual training, and virtual and augmented reality components to accelerate skill development and mastery. Okay, so what about e-learning? Of course, you can eliminate most of these costs and rapidly deploy training with asynchronous self-directed e-learning. Just send your learners to your learning management system, or LMS, and have them advance through a series of videos, online modules, and assessments. Most large organizations have made significant investments in LMSs and building out e-learning catalogs. Self-directed e-learning is the hottest segment in learning and development, and it's projected to grow to a $325 billion business globally in the near term. With e-learning, people may consume training content and learn on their own terms anywhere, anytime, on any device. It is a cheap and easy way to train lots of people fast with little friction. But driving real learning through self-paced e-learning courses has some serious drawbacks, as anyone who's tried it will tell you. The truth is, when left on their own, most people abandon the training. Studies indicate that more than 90% of online learners never complete their courses. And e-learning on its own doesn't work well for teaching complex skill sets and competencies. Because the truth is, people learn better when they collaborate with other people. Of course, there are certain subjects, such as compliance and technical how-to instruction, in which e-learning excels. Even so, because e-learning leads to a set-it-and-forget-it mentality, leaders and learning and development professionals tend to take a hands-off approach to directing and monitoring e-learning activities. This dilutes the potential return on investment that e-learning offers, because either learners abandon the coursework or just go through the motions to check off the requirements so that they look good on reports. I've observed competent people fail an end-of-course assessment that should be so easy that a cat could pass it because they click through the content on the LMS like zombies without paying attention, just to check the boxes. Most humans need more than a set of videos to truly learn and adopt new skills and behaviors. Albert Bandura's social learning theory posits that people learn best in groups where they have the opportunity to observe, emulate, and practice new skills together. People wish to communicate, collaborate, and at times commiserate as they stretch through the process of shifting their mindset and acquiring new skills. Humans long for social engagement and the shared community and experience of a classroom cohort. Simply put, e-learning is missing that social component, so by itself, it's not an effective way to develop competency and drive behavior change. This is exactly why synchronous classroom-based and virtual instructor-led training is and will continue to be an important cornerstone of learning and development initiatives. Enter virtual instructor-led training. Virtual instructor-led training, or VILT for short, blends the social learning benefits of classroom-based training with the speed, agility, and cost-effectiveness of e-learning without the wasted expenses associated with the physical classroom. This means that organizations are able to deliver more high-quality training and rapidly upskill more people at a much lower cost, which generates a far higher return on the training investment. The good news is, for a large swath of curricula, VILT, delivered well, is just as effective as classroom training. Furthermore, because a virtual training curriculum can be chunked into shorter training sessions, it is often superior to classroom training when it comes to making learning stick. Numerous academic studies have proven that humans can better retain and apply learned skills when training is delivered in succinct, easy-to-consume chunks. Richard E. Mayer's segmenting principle describes how chunking breaks complex curricula and courses into concise virtual sessions. For example, 8 hours of physical classroom training might be broken into smaller segments, like 8 1-hour sessions or 4 2-hour sessions, with time between each session for practice, homework assignments, and blended e-learning content. Rather than the fire hose in the mouth format that physical classroom training typically requires, VILT redesigns the learning path to work the way humans learn best, in short sequential chunks of information that layer one lesson upon another and present opportunities for repetition and practice. Learning outcomes improve further when there is time between these chunks of training for participants to practice new skills in the real world, along with supportive instructor coaching. These breaks between training sessions provide a faster feedback loop that accelerates the cognitive process of learning. However, this form of on-the-job experiential learning, learning by doing, is impractical with most classroom-based training because of the cost and travel constraints. Compared with traditional classroom training, the combination of chunking and experiential learning in a VILT environment is often a better investment for organizations. When used together, these two strategies improve the probability that training will stick and the desired behavioral changes will be actualized. While it is certainly more challenging to recreate the social and collaborative environment of the physical classroom in a virtual setting, VILT more than makes up for the shortcoming in other important ways. Agility and flexibility. Virtual training may be delivered in almost any configuration over any duration. Low risk and rapid iteration. It is easier to experiment and pilot virtual training initiatives because the risk and cost of failure is low. Likewise, virtual training may be deployed quickly and continuously improved with little risk to the organization or negative impact on the learners. No walls and few limits. Learners may access virtual training sessions from almost anywhere. All they need is an internet connection and a connected device. Session review. Virtual sessions may be recorded and made available for learners to review in the LMS. If a participant misses a session or needs a quick refresher, it is easy to catch up and stay on track. Enhanced and extended communication. Interactive breakout groups and discussion boards make it easy for participants and instructors to collaborate, get feedback, and communicate both inside and outside the classroom. Structure and freedom. Virtual training provides both the structured social learning environment that humans require for true behavioral change and freedom from the confines of the physical classroom. The virtual training structure, a combination of scheduled live training sessions, in-classroom activities and breakout sessions, homework assignments, self-paced learning, and accountability, makes it far superior to e-learning and most classroom-based training. And one more fringe benefit of virtual training? It's green. Most modern organizations are focused on reducing their overall carbon footprint. In similar fashion, many of their employees are concerned about climate change and sustainability. According to an Open University study, virtual training consumes about 87% less energy and produces 85% fewer CO2 emissions than classroom-based training. Just one more reason to love virtual training. Chapter 4. Experience is everything. As our virtual training business at Sellsgravy exploded, many of my peers in our industry segment called to ask about how we'd so quickly pivoted from in-classroom training to virtual. After I shared my story about building our virtual training studios, the responses that followed were typically along the lines of, "Wow, you are way ahead of the curve. Your timing was impeccable. You were so far ahead of everyone else. And you really got lucky." I heard "you got lucky" a lot, even from my own family. Trust me, in the moment, with so many other training companies taking it on the chin because they were not able to switch to virtual, I felt lucky. But it wasn't luck. It was the accumulation of years of observation, experimentation, and hard work. A long time ago, we had recognized that virtual instructor-led training was important and it was a methodology that we would need to master to be competitive in the future. We understood what didn't work and why people have an aversion to virtual training. We also knew what we as trainers didn't like about delivering virtual training. We were convinced that the biggest obstacle to gaining wider adoption of virtual training was the experience. You see, too often, virtual instructor-led training felt impersonal, low-energy, two-dimensional, and uncollaborative. For most learners, it was about enduring a painfully boring and awful experience rather than engaging in actual learning. The good news is that it's possible to control most of the things that make virtual training so bad. Instructors who are unprepared or not trained to teach effectively in the virtual classroom. Poor training delivery methods and practices. Suboptimal virtual training production, including lackluster video, audio, backdrops, and framing. Media and graphics that are ill-suited for on-screen viewing. Failure to adopt and master the technology required to effectively manage a virtual classroom. Poor instructional design, and treating virtual training as an afterthought. All of these elements and more are easily resolved if you have the will and desire to do so. And this begins and ends with a focus on the training mission. Five truths about virtual training adoption. The most frequent concerns that learning and development professionals have about virtual is that clients, internal customers, and learners won't accept it. This was our biggest worry too, but our experience has taught us five truths. 1. People prefer face-to-face training over virtual training, especially if they've had a bad experience with virtual training in the past, which many have. 2. If the only option for training is virtual, most customers, those are the people who are paying for or ordering the training, will begrudgingly accept that option. 3. If the cost, including travel materials and lost productivity, of virtual training compared to physical training is similar, most customers will choose classroom-based training. 4. If the cost gap, including travel, materials, and lost productivity, between virtual and physical training is large, most customers will strongly consider and often choose virtual training over classroom-based training. 5. When the virtual training experience is outstanding, clients and learners are much more likely to choose virtual training over classroom-based training for future deliveries, and they will book far more future trainings than they would if they were only considering in-person sessions. The brutal truth is that the experience matters more than anything. When you make virtual training a great experience for your stakeholders, they will begin to trust it and be open to more. The one thing you can take to the bank, though, is that they won't accept virtual training if the experience is awful, no matter what the cost. If the choice is between affordable but bad virtual training and unaffordable in-person training, customers will choose no training at all. There are few people who haven't had the pleasure of sitting through agonizing virtual training sessions. Death by voiceover PowerPoint delivered by a disengaged or clueless instructor has an especially bitter flavor. I remember watching in dismay as my son endured one of his professors drone on for 20 minutes in a completely monotone voiceover while a single slide with 10 small bullet points filled the screen. The professor's audio was bad, and he never showed his face on video. Not once did he ask a question or engage his students. There wasn't even any movement on the slide. It was excruciating. And my son? Well, he eventually drifted off into an app on his phone. I was livid that I was paying his private university $40,000 a year for this crap, and I fired off a scathing email to the president of his college. My experience was exactly why so many of the executives we work with were dead set against virtual training. It was also why our client stakeholders believed that the cost for virtual training should be a fraction of what they paid for in-classroom training. The reason there has been so much resistance from leaders, trainers, and participants to virtual training is because the experience has been awful. It's not because of the quality of the curriculum or content. It's not because of the talent of the trainer. It's because of the experience. What matters most is the way virtual training is delivered and how it makes both the trainer and the participants feel. You see, when the virtual learning experience is emotionally positive, participants are more engaged, readily embrace new competencies, and the training sticks. They are more likely to show up to class and be open to future virtual training. Trainers enjoy their work and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.